Hello and welcome to this first SynchroTech webinar. My name is Janne Kuschke and I'm the creative director here. For those who don't know us yet, SynchroTech is a startup from Switzerland that manufactures professional SLS 3D printers for research, prototyping and production. If you'd like to learn more about our technology and especially our latest all-in-one system, the SynchroTech S2, please visit our website synchrotech.com. But enough about us. Today I'm very happy to be joined by our longtime customer, designer and architect Stefan Henrich. Welcome, Stefan.
Hi, Yannick. Hi, everybody.
Before I let you start with your course, just a quick reminder for everyone joining live to feel free to ask any questions that may arise about 3D printing in general, about selective laser sintering, or perhaps about Stefan's designing process. You can do so via the YouTube chat and my colleagues will collect them. And hopefully we will get to answer most of the questions at the end. Also, it is worth to stay tuned until the end of the webinar because we have a special surprise planned for all the creative design minds among you. Now, without further ado, I give the word to Stefan.
Thank you, Yannick. Dear viewers, thank you for joining us today and welcome to our first webinar, The Potential of Selective Laser Sintering. My name is Stefan Henrich. I run a small but nice design studio in Stuttgart in Germany that is called Stefan Henrich Robotic Design und Architektur. And there I do additive design for SLS almost every day, not exclusively. So let's just begin. Let me introduce to you what we will be interested in for the next 30 minutes about. My presentation has two parts. Part A will give you a brief refreshing of how SLS technology works in principle, of how an SLS part is built up during the additive process. Also, we will have a look at other 3D printing technologies, so you have a comparison. And we will have a look at software quickly. Then in part B, I want to show you some construction examples that illustrate what SLS technology can do and what we can use it for. So, the potential of selective laser sintering, for short, SLS. How does SLS work at all? Therefore, I have this little animated diagram for you. So this is an SLS machine, basically a box with more boxes inside. On the right, you have a powder reservoir that contains powder needed to build up the part. And on the left, a build chamber with a build platform in it. In this heated chamber, the part is going to be built. So the platform at the bottom of the powder reservoir is lifted a tiny bit. A plate transports a portion of fresh powder onto the build platform. This is then the first layer, which is then partly sintered by a laser beam. Then the build platform lowers its seat position a tiny bit. The powder reservoir platform lifts a tiny bit. Again, the plate transports powder for the next layer onto the freshly built layer in the build chamber. The build chamber is heated as a temperature so that the laser just needs to add a last bit of energy to melt the next layer on top of the layer before. Yeah, and so on and so on. The cool thing is the sintered part is supported by the unsintered powder surrounding it so that no support structure is needed. And the process therefore can come with a huge amount of geometric freedom for the part that is going to be built. For example, you could sinter interlocking rings that don't touch each other, like in a chain, or bodies that float inside of other bodies, like spheres inside of a sphere. Yeah, and once the part is built up completely, the machine cools down, the part needs to be sandblasted carefully to get rid of the surrounding unsintered powder. Yeah, and the part is ready to be used. Of course, SLS is not the only additive process. There's also FDM, short for fused deposition modeling. Again, a diagram, this time no animation. What you can see here on the top is an extruder that gets fed with thermoplastic filament from the top. Wheels transport it then through the extruder towards a heated nozzle that melts the filament. And by moving the extruder horizontally over the build platform, the nozzle draws the first layer of the part onto the platform. Once the layer is completed, the platform lowers about the thickness of the layer, and the next layer is melted onto the previous one, and by moving the extruder nozzle in X and Y, the next layer emerges, and so on, until the part is completed. Yeah, and in this process, we don't have such thing as a powder bed that would support our part. so that when the geometry of the part contains overhangs with more than a certain angle, typically 45 or 60 degrees, we need a support structure in order not to extrude filament in the air. Once the part is completed, the support structure needs to be removed. The structure can be printed from the same material as the part itself or from another material. But in both cases, the used filament is transformed, so melted in a way that it cannot be reused just like this. So unlike unsintered powder in SLS, which gets sieved and can then be mixed with fresh powder and to re-enter the process for the next print. Yeah, and one third process I wanted to show you is at the same time the first additive process that has been invented in the 80s, stereolithography, for short SLA. Here we have a container filled with photosensitive polymers, a slurry resin, and at the bottom of a resin tank there is a build platform that is then lifted upwards layer height by layer height during the printing process, and a UV light source or laser is scanning the first horizontal slice of the part to solidify the liquid resin, of course only there where it's touched by the light, into rigid plastic. Then the build platform lifts a tiny bit and the laser starts over. So little by little, the part, which is hanging at the bottom side of the build platform, gets lifted out of the tank. As you can imagine here, critical overhangs in the part's geometry point upwards in this process and need to be stabilized by support structure as well. So once the part is finished, the structure needs to be removed. Here, we have a direct comparison of the three processes. There are other processes, of course, but I chose these three because they are pretty common at this moment. We see the forms in which the materials can come vary. So SLS works with powder, FDM with filament, SLA with liquid resin. For my work, the most important information here is the mechanical properties. So for example, SLS gives us strong and in comparison almost isotropic parts. That means parts that are almost equally robust in X, Y, and Z dimension. Secondly, the construction freedom that you have in SLS is unbeaten due to the fact that the part is naturally supported by the powder bed in which it emerges. You can create geometries without worrying how to remove possible support structures or damage the part removing these structures. And this is the reason why I often go for SLS parts. Even though you have way better quality of surface and more details, more defined details in SLA. That would be an advantage here. Yeah, and of course, FDM is developing a lot lately. Most interesting here are processes working with continuous fibers in X and Y direction. Yeah, now that we got to know a few things about hardware needed to 3D print, we should have a look at the software part. Very often 3D printers ask for STL files that are then processed by a slicer, so the 3D print can be built up layer by layer. STL stands for Standard Triangle Language. That means it deals with triangles, no quads or no NURBS or solids or curves, but triangles, polygons. So STL is a polygon format. The work to construct a 3D object in CAD most of the time does not deal with polygons. So here is a conversion step necessary to make it a polygon object. So why not going for a polygon modeler in the first place? And this is what I do. To create my additive design, I use a mixture of software, but one very essential part is done in 3D modeling software, native polygon modelers. Yeah, and this comes, at least for my usage, with the advantage that you can profit of the fast and intuitive modeling methods that is used in these softwares. And in comparison to CAD softwares that maybe require 2D sketching first, that you then pull in a third dimension, you add fillets to end up with something that still looks a bit boxy maybe, which is pretty good for milling parts, of course. In this case, you really profit of the geometric freedom of 3D printing, especially in SLS, from the very beginning. Yeah, geometric freedom means that the part can become more geometrically complex, and this can be an advantage in lightweight construction. And in additive manufacturing, lightweight construction is directly correlated with an economic construction. That means the less of a relative expensive material you use, the lighter and the cheaper the parts get. So now part B, construction examples. Here I want to show you some objects I created where additive design plays an important role. Just let's start with the first one. It's a table design. It's actually the table I use in my office every day. Its dimensions are 2.20 m by 1.10 m, so it's not so small. It has a real lightweight support structure, you can see here, that consists of a aluminum tubing that forms multiple tetrahedrons, and it is held together then by 22 polyamide 12 SLS connecting pieces. The table's feet have hinges to level the table or the desktop and to adjust the height. So the feet consist each of three parts joined by two hinges, and they are printed in one shot, so there's no assembly necessary. Yeah, I wanted to show you this table because maybe you get a feeling of how load-bearing functional parts could look when they are designed for SLS. Here they look metallic actually, but they are in polyamide 12, so they have just a chrome finish. By the way, you cannot print metals in SLS machines. People often ask me this, that's why I mention this here. Only polymers, of course. Polyamide can be filled with aluminum particles. That is then a material called alumite, but it basically stays a polymer material. And one important thing with this table is also that the tubing entering the SLS connectors comes from very varying directions. That makes a fabrication process necessary that gives us parts with a more or less isotropic mechanical property. And this is what SLS can do. I actually start to sell these tables now. Just let me know if you're interested. Next up, the design of a pushboard chair. Some time ago, when I was working on a robot hand, I ran into this NASA research from the 90s. It's about a branching, fractal, grasping geometry, the bush robot, which they call a hypothetical machine. It's about simulating how to grasp a body of any shape or how to automatically adapt a branching grasping device to anybody's geometry. Yeah, I found that rather interesting. So I thought, what if a chair would use this principle? What would a chair look like if it became a bushboard chair? So I started to sketch a chair referring to this principle. This is what you can see here. At the same time, I asked myself, what would that mean if you want to mix a sitting device and a grasping device that looks then like a bush, a thorn bush, actually. What is this, a chair or a bush or a trap even? Shall we dare to sit on that? So the chair becomes something else as well. It becomes a psycho-furniture. The user has to take a risk first in order to profit then of the relaxation. He needs to overcome his fear to release his body in a repulsive-looking spiky bush. Yeah, the bush robot is a kinematic, so to say, passive robotic furniture design. The 4 feet of the chair are supporting articulated branching systems, four, and of three sub-branchings ending in 24 contact stars. Each tree system has 9 pivoting points of 1 or 2 degrees of freedom that allow a virtual sitting surface to adjust smoothly to the human body. The chair was thought to consist mainly of selective laser-sintered PA12 parts with some flexible TPU parts. This is then actually the setup I fed into Solid Thinking Inspire, which is a simulating software, to first learn about if the design is statically feasible in polyamide 12, turned out it is. And secondly, to structurally optimize the design to only distribute material there where it's needed statically. Yeah, and the third reason is to implement zones of adapted flexibility to control the kinematics of the trees. Yeah, here on the right, you see in blue the branching system with its pivoting zones. I refined the design and I thought it's time to have a first laser-centered model in scale 1 to 6. Why actually 1 to 6? Because fully articulated figures are available in 1 to 6, and I wanted to know and learn by this way where exactly to put the contact elements that touch the human body and to distribute them then accordingly. Here is our dummy, the example human. Yeah, and the endings of the branching touching the body are realized as a segmented bendable surface supported by multiple flexing cantilevers to adjust to the human body. The contact surface is then topped by a lamellar system to add anti-skid properties. This is what you see here. I had then the entire chair sintered, of course cut into pieces to make it fit into the machine. Here you see all the PA12 parts, polyamide 12 parts, before being assembled. And here you see the chair after assembly. The white parts are from polyamide 12 and the black ones are from flexible TPU, exactly in the pivoting zones. Yeah, and of course the principle of a self-adapting surface support structure can be very interesting in vehicle design, for seating design, and most interesting in autonomous cars. Yeah, what you see here is the design of a monolithic SLS robot hand with an SLS glove. It has been for a movie production by M4. M4 stands for Mind Machine Making Myth, and it is a practice between movie making, fiction, and architecture based in Bangkok, Thailand, for the movie Le Car-Car, which was an adaptation of the E.T.R. Hoffmann plot Der Rat Crespel, in English Councillor Crespel, maybe some of you know. Therefore, we had this three-finger robot hand that plays a part in this movie. It is monolithic, that means it's one piece, no assembly necessary, just motors and cables to move the fingers are clicked in. The fingers are analog to the human hand, underactivated. There are no multi-piece articulations, just integral hinges that are game-free and maintenance-free due to consisting of one seamless topology. The quasi-woven cloth is highly flexible, even though it's also done from polyamide 12, so the same material as the rather rigid hand itself. Also from one continuous topology that creates a fabric of all independent strings within the fabric surface. And this is leading us then to our last examples for today, the translation of textile properties into selective laser sintered objects. Yeah, the design of a SLS textile. It's an example of function integration additive design for SLS. A wallet from one continuous polygon mesh. Again, there's no assembly necessary. So the rigid parts and the quasi-textile parts are one. We have a three-layer knitting on the inside, which you see on the, which you see here. We have a two counter spiral layers for a stretch functionality. And then on the outside, here and here, we have something that works analog like a chain armor to limit the stretch functionality. So we have textile properties translated into a sintered object. The size and the orientation of the knit is given by its position in the piece. This is why the mesh is not straight diagonal, but has a certain swing in order to allow more stretch at the same construction height of the layers. Yeah, and here is my new wallet design that I will start selling soon. It's also printed in one shot, covered with two interwoven hexagonal meshes that form together a pentagonal Cairo pattern then. And on the bottom, yeah, you see some alternative colors. On the bottom right, you have a pattern which is based on a triaxial weaving. Yeah, thank you for your attention. I really hope it was a bit entertaining and you enjoyed. Thank you, Sintratec team. And now I'm curious, to hear about your questions.
All right. Thank you, Stefan, for your time. And thank you, everybody who joined us. One question that we got in the chat, thank you for that, was about enclosures and how you deal with certain volumes. I'm just going to read it to you. Speaking of lightweight constructions, is it possible to create outlets to remove unsintered material in an enclosed volume after the print is finished? Or how do you go to designing certain volumes that have unsintered powder?
Yeah, I would go for a shell directly. So you have a defined thickness, a wall thickness, and yeah, where powder is sintered, and then inside there is unsintered powder. And this powder, you have to foresee a little hole or multiple holes, so you can enter with the nozzle of your sanding device to sand the unsintered powder out of the object. Yeah, there you need a little bit of experience of how big the hole must be or how many holes you have to foresee. But yeah, basically this is the way to get rid of the powder inside of volumes. Yeah.
In your experience, how big do you think does this outlet have to be? That was another question.
Really depends on the geometry. It's yeah, not so easy to say. Some, yeah, let's say the hinge of my table design. If I go back in the presentation a little bit, that could be an example. Here we go. It has actually an outlet in a position where I thought that the powder, the unsintered powder, which is in the gap of the hinge, would be difficult to make it leave this gap. So I foresee a little hole of yeah, how much, 5 millimeter diameter, just to have a starting point from where powder could leave this cylinder. Yeah, in other geometries, it's something completely different. I think it's, yeah, from case to case, you have to check. Often, yeah, these can be a detail that makes a second iteration necessary. Yeah, but with more experience, you will get it.
All right, good. I think that's all the questions we've got so far. So again, thank you very much for the information and for the presentation. And before everybody else leaves right now, we have a little special, as I mentioned in my introduction, for all the creative minds among you. So if you have a fascinating design that you always wanted to hold in your own hands, printed by SLS, this is now your unique chance. Send us your idea, your concept, your 3D model. We will print it and ship it to you and then feature it on our channels. First 10 lucky people will receive the part printed by our new Sintratec S2 system, of course, so long as the design is printable in that form. So if you're interested into that, reach out to us via email at info@sintratec.com and make sure to use the subject line webinar so we know what it is about. Okay, so thank you everybody for joining us and watching, and thank you, Stefan.
Thank you.